I'm Selmateacher7, also known as Mr. Barry by my students. And today is day number 8 for the A+ Network Control Operator class. And what we're going to be doing today is looking into RAM, that is Random Access Memory. We're going to be looking at the different generations of RAM and also how to upgrade RAM and do other things with RAM. All right, well, let's get started with the lesson.
What's in the news? Intel's Haswell processors work with DDR3 memory, and Skylake and Kaby Lake processors take DDR4 memory. In this chart, we can see what DDR3 memory looks like, and we have a notch here. And here's DDR4, and as you can see, the notch is in a different location, so you can't put in a DDR3 into a DDR4 slot, or vice versa. It has been rumored that Intel's Cannon Lake, due out in late 2017, and Coffee Lake, due out in 2018, processors will also be working with DDR4 memory. We will look at the most common types used today, mainly DDR3 and DDR4. RAM, main memory, primary memory, or system memory is a computer storage location that allows information to be stored and accessed quickly from random locations within RAM on a memory module. Because the information is accessed randomly instead of sequentially like what would be found on a tape drive, the computer is able to access the data much faster than it would if it was reading the hard drive. In fact, the difference in speed is 1,000 times. However, unlike CDs and the hard drive, RAM is volatile memory and requires power in order to keep the data accessible. If power is lost, all data contained within that memory is also lost. The computer loads the operating system and drivers into memory, which allows the CPU to process the instructions very quickly. If too many programs or applications are opened, the computer will swap the data in the memory between the RAM and the hard disk drive. As computers have increased in speed and capacity, RAM has changed too, to meet the new demands imposed upon it, with several different variations of RAM. Some of the more common examples of DIMM, RIM, SIM, and SODIMM. Below is an example of an image of a DDR4 SDRAM computer memory module and what the typical desktop computer memory card will look like. So if you have a desktop computer system that you purchased in the last few years, most likely you'd be taking DDR4. Now, desktop memory differs greatly from laptop memory. On desktops, we call these memory modules DIMMs. But within laptops, we call them SODIMMs. Here we see an example of SODIMM memory. Something that like this would be usually found in a laptop computer. Let's now go into the generations of DDR memory and see how things have changed. Back in 2001, we had DDR1. And here we can see that ran at 2.5 volts. And the speed was 266 million transfers per second there. And the density was 128 megabytes. Then in 2004, DDR2 came out and it had a 28% decrease in the voltage and went down to 1.8 volts. It was a 50% faster basically at 400 million transfers per second, and the density was doubled, and then it came up to 256 megabytes. In 2007, DDR3 came out. We saw it was a decrease of 16.6% in the voltage, went down to 1.5 volts. The speed was 166% increase, up to 1,066 million transfers per second, and the density, 300% increase. So now you have 1 gigabyte of density. In 2014, we have DDR4 that came out, and we had a drop in the voltage by 20%, down to 1.2 volts. The speed was 100% increase. Now we have it at 2,133 million transfers per second. And the density, 300% again. And now we have it at 4 gigs. So really, the picture above tells the whole story of how things increased for DDR memory. Here's another picture showing how DDR4 improves on DDR3's performance. The long name for DDR4 is Double Data Rate 4th Generation Synchronous Dynamic Random Access Memory. Try saying that 10 times fast. The primary advantages of DDR4 as opposed to its predecessor DDR3 include higher module density and lower voltage requirements. Coupled with higher data rate transfer speeds, DDR4 operates at a voltage of just 1.2 volts with frequencies between 1600 and 3200 megahertz compared to frequencies of 800 to 2133 megahertz, and voltages requirements of 1.5 or 1.65 volts for DDR3. As this chart shows, there are some interesting performance specs that go with DDR4 memory. DDR4 is 20% more efficient, yet uses less electricity. It is twice the speed in memory bandwidth, so 2 times more data can pass through it compared to DDR3. And the modules are 2 times denser, meaning that you can have twice the memory as you did in a DDR3 system. DDR4 memory comes in a 288-pin DIMM modules, similar in size to the standard 240-pin modules for DDR3. The pins are spaced more closely, that is being 0.85 millimeters instead of the 1.0 millimeters to fit the increased amount within the same 5 1/4 inch or 133.35 millimeter standard DIMM length. But the height is increased slightly from the 30.35 millimeter that we saw in the DDR3, and it's now at 31.25 millimeters. To make signal routing easier, and the thickness is also increased upwards to 1.2 millimeter from a mere 1 millimeter to accommodate more signal layers. DDR4 SO-DIMMs have 260 pins rather than DDR3's 204 pins, which are also spaced closer, being 0.5 millimeters rather than the 0.6, and are 1 millimeter wider, that is 68.6 millimeters rather than 67.6 millimeters. But they remain the same 30 millimeter in height. We also have DDR3L SODIMM. Now these are found in the newest Chromebooks and other portable devices. We'll get into that detail in just a moment. Here is some common laptop memory SODIMM modules as we compare them to each other. So this first one here would be the SODIMM DDR1. Notice we have 200 pins. With DDR2, 200 pins. Same overall size and pin configuration as found in DDR1, which makes it really confusing. This can destroy a DDR2 memory module, however, if you were to switch the two. Then we have DDR3. Now, DDR3 has 204 pins, as you can see down here on this diagram. Now let's look into DDR for desktop memory. Here we have the DDR1. Now in the book, you can actually take a memory module and set it on the page of the book and then line up the notch. And that will tell you whether it's a DDR1, DDR2, DDR3, or even a DDR4. So use this chart to find which type of memory you're looking at. Let's now go with DDR3 prices. They do appear to be rising. On this first one here, we have 16 gigs of DDR3 memory. It's now around $100. 6 months ago, it was around $60. That's an increase of $40. And 12 months ago, it was around $55. If we go back 24 months ago, it was $110. DDR4 prices are rising as well. Here's also 16 gigs of DDR4 memory is now selling for around $95. 6 months ago, the same memory was only $61. Now the question usually comes up around this time, talking about SODIMMs and the memory that we find in portable systems such as laptops. And the question that comes up says, well, if I have a laptop that takes DDR3L, can I just stick in a DDR3 memory? Well, here's the answer. The difference between these two RAMs is nothing but the voltage consumption. The DDR3L RAM consumes a lesser voltage compared to the standard DDR3 SODIMM. Also, the lower the operating voltage of the memory, the faster the memory can be theoretically operated because the transition from 0 to a 1 state requires less of a voltage shift. So, the question comes in, can I just put my DDR3L into a DDR3 SODIMM? The answer would be no, because they take a different voltage. Now we're going to look at a comparison of a few of Intel's processors and what type of memory they are designed for. Here we're going to be looking at the processor type or name at the top. Remember, these are all Intel processors. The release date of each, and then the motherboard's chipset series, and the DDR type. First off, we have Haswell. It came out in 2014. The motherboard chipset would be 00s. So an example would be 85. So you might find the H or the B85 chipset on that motherboard, and it takes DDR3. With the Skylake that came out in late 2015, we now have the motherboard series in the 100s. So you might have a motherboard that says something like Z150 or H150 or the B150 or even 160. This one does take DDR4 memory, which is kind of nice. Next on our list is Kaby Lake. It came out in early 2017, just a few weeks ago, in fact. And the motherboard chipset series is the 200s. So anything in the 200s is working for the Kaby Lake. So you might have a 210, 220, 230. In this case, we see a 250. I have already seen motherboards that were 270. It takes DDR4 memory as well. Next on our list is Cannon Lake. That's coming out in late 2017, if it stays on schedule. And the motherboard chipset series are in the 300s for that. So we'd have a chipset that would be something like 350, and it takes DDR4 memory. After that is Coffee Lake, which comes out in early 2018. That one again will be a chipset of 300. So you may have a chipset that says something like 330 or 340 or 330 or 350 even on that motherboard. The memory type would be DDR4. Okay, now before we get into the break time, I'm going to show a quick video on installing memory.
We'll be installing the RAM. Press straight down, apply about 7 pounds worth of pressure, straight down, once the memory has been installed, we can now install the DVD drive and the hard drive.
So in that video, I was installing memory into a desktop system that was unplugged. So that's one thing that you want to make sure, that the system is unplugged, power down and all that, before opening up the case and installing new memory. When installing RAM to a desktop system, make sure you press down, straight down, onto the slot, as you're seeing here in this picture. So he's taking the DIMM and he's pressing straight down evenly, with the notch lining up, and it's going to be about 7 pounds of force. Once it's all the way down, these little retaining clips will clip and snap into place, telling you that it's all secure. Usually what I do too is I take a flashlight and I look over it to make sure that it is all the way in and not at an angle, like this side be in and this side just be up a little bit, because that would cause major headaches down the road if that was the case. Let's now look into laptop and upgrading memory on laptops. Within the laptop, simply slide the module into the memory slot until it's all the way down and secured, pressed in firmly. Then press it down on the top. You should hear the retaining clip snap into place once the memory is totally secured. Now, before we go into break and lab, let me go over those steps again for putting in memory into a laptop, just so that we know everything from beginning to end. First off, if you have a laptop there, make sure that it's off and unplugged from the wall. Then remove the laptop's battery. Disconnect any cabling, such as an external keyboard or Ethernet cable that's going into the laptop. Using a small Phillips screwdriver, you want to remove this door. It's a little tiny door to the memory compartment, and that's always found at the bottom, so you would have to place the laptop upside down onto a soft cloth so you don't scratch it up when you're working on it. Once the memory cover is removed, you should see this memory slot here. Ground yourself before touching the memory module. That can be done by touching any grounded metal surface. Carefully remove the new memory module from its new packaging. Avoid touching the connectors. Doing so can reduce connectivity because your fingers do have oil. Locate an empty memory slot, as you can see This one is not empty. It has one already in it, but let's just say this one was empty. Then pick up the memory module by its sides and aim its connectors towards the socket so the connectors are here. Slide the memory module into place, like this arrow was showing at this angle. Once the memory module is fully inserted to the socket, press down at the top of the edge of this memory module, straight down. You should hear the retaining clips snap into place once it's all the way secured. Then replace the memory compartment cover or door, lock it down with the screw that came with it. Just want to make sure that you don't over tighten the screw too. Reinstall the battery, the main battery, to the laptop. You may then set the laptop right side up, open up the clamshell, turn it on, and make sure that everything is working properly. Once you have it made sure of that, go ahead and return it to the customer. Alrighty, if you have any questions about installation of memory, either on a desktop or a laptop or even on a Chromebook, don't hesitate to ask me now during class. If not, it's now time for a break. For those watching on YouTube, please thumbs up the video, share, and comment. I want to give a big thank you for all those who participated in the audience, and have a wonderful day. Bye-bye.